guys just say hi to the internet? Say hi to the internet, Hank, and everyone else. Seekers, London Seekers, woo! You guys are famous now, awesome. All right, so as part of my talk here tonight for London Seekers, like I said, I'm gonna tell you guys a story. I'm gonna tell you what Paradigm Shift is. And Paradigm Shift is a project that I started about 5 years ago, but you could say I started it quite some time before that. So we'll get into that. And my name is Brendan Culleton, and on the internet, I also go by a handle or a code name, as I like to think of it, which is Skull Babylon. Now, a lot of people hear the name Skull Babylon, and they're just like, oh, that's a weird name. That sort of sounds like a little, like, scary, maybe, because a skull sometimes means death, but at the same time, skull also means rebirth. Everything that is one thing is also, like, the exact opposite of it. So if something means life, it also means death. If skull means one thing, it can mean many things. And in this case, my interpretation is that it means rebirth, and then Babylon refers to the system that we are in, you could say. It refers to culture, it refers to mass media, it refers to the way we live, the way we buy things, the control mechanisms that are in place on top of people, and more so than that, what we can also create within this control mechanism, within Babylon. So, long story short, Skull Babylon means rebirth from within. Rebirth the system from within. We want to change the world. Everybody here is here tonight because they like the idea of being able to change the world. My name, my code name, is just sort of another idea of that. But more so than anything, it's rebirth from within the self. Rebirth from within our own habits, the way how we go about doing things, because as many of us have heard, if you want to change the world, it starts with yourself. If everybody swept their own doorstep, the whole world would be clean. So that's a big part of what I've been encouraging people, and the name is just kind of another portal into that idea of shrouded in mystery, among many other things. And it can also mean much more than that. So that's one of my names on the internet, and the internet is kind of pretty close to where this story begins. So the story begins, you could say, from an early childhood, obviously. I grew up being a curious kid. Like many of us, and I was always just looking for different explanations as to how things work. I would be someone who would take things apart. I had a grandfather who he himself was very intelligent and encouraged that inquisitive nature within me. Through my natural just growing up and being in the reality that I was in, certain things happened along my path. When I was 14 years old or 13 years old, when I was in grade 9, that's when 9/11 happened. And obviously 9/11 is a big event. Now the reason why it fits within my story is because when 9/11 happens, as shocking as it was, as shifting as it was for the entire planet, there's been ripple effects that have come out of it that have actually been quite positive. Now what I mean by this is that down the road, other people, thanks to the beauty of the internet, they started expressing theories, as many of you have heard, about 9/11 not being the official story that we've been told. So anyways, long story short, I came across these ideas through the internet. But that led me to my next process, which was, what else can I learn? What else is on the internet? This is interesting. This isn't the stuff that they're teaching me in school. The internet was beginning to blossom right at the time that I was blossoming into that like adolescent stage. I was going through, you know, 13, 14, 15, 16. I was starting to question who it is, who I want to be, and more of this information was coming to the surface. And bit by bit, I was sort of just like taking it in and everything. And it wasn't until I was in about, it wasn't until I was about in university that I really started to embody more of the spiritual ideas and the spiritual practices. I began practicing yoga. Yoga was actually a simple thing that led me into this whole project. And I guess I'll just say, even just for the video, like the whole project, Paradigm Shift, where it is now, and I should have said this at the beginning, but what it is now, it is a global community of Paradigm Shift communities. It is a global network of Paradigm Shift communities. Paradigm Shift London is the chapter, the community, the branch, the seed, whatever you want to call it, that I helped start here in London. And then I started it in my college, which is where I'm hopscotching back to, because that's where it all began. I started in my college, it evolved from there outside of my college, and then through that I used the magic of the internet
to use my media skills. As we mentioned, I do video and everything like that. So my intention was to document the ongoing shift in consciousness, to create a physical community, and to be able to show other people how it happened, and more so how they can do it too. So how they can do it, and to encourage them and give them the tools, and most importantly, the inspiration to do so through my own actions, through the actions of myself and my community and my friends. So now, what Paradigm Shift is as a global thing, there are separate Paradigm Shift communities, well not separate, but there are just individual Paradigm Shift communities across the globe now. It started off as one here in London, and now there are over 30, 40, 50 varying degrees of activity. What a Paradigm Shift community is, in a very simple sense, it is a group that regularly meets up to have open-minded discussion and meditation. It very much like what this is. And that's actually part of the story, is that I came to Seekers, and Seekers actually inspired me to say, like, hey, I can do this in my club. I can do this in my college as a club. So just to finish what Paradigm Shift is now, there's a bunch of videos that I put up online, other things that we do as a community. I encourage people to engage in acts of shiftivism, as I call it, which is sort of a word that I made up, but I made it real. I made it up. What does that mean? You know, I made it into something more so than anything. And shiftivism, very simply, is the idea of using love to plant seeds to help assist in the awakening of consciousness. So shiftivism includes things like free hugs. It includes things like standing downtown with a sign that says, like, we are love, or love is the answer. Something that's gonna catch someone's attention, make them shift, make their paradigm shift, get their attention, and also create synchronistic opportunities where people will come together and be like, hey, I like your sign, what's this about? And then they engage. And if that person is part of a paradigm shift community, suddenly that person who talked to them is now connected to the community. So again, these communities, what we have in London, through Paradigm Shift London, every Friday, we meet at a downtown yoga studio and we have open-minded discussion and meditation. Out of the discussions comes personal development. It comes the strength that community creates. A lot of people, as I mentioned, I was getting into yoga, I was also getting into topics like lucid dreaming. A lot of people come to Paradigm Shift with these interests, with what have brought many of you here, this curiosity that we can easily put under the term of spiritual. There was a time where maybe even for other people in here, sometimes we have like a hesitancy of be like, oh, is that spiritual or not? You know, should I be calling that spiritual or not? Now everything's spiritual to me. It's all infinite. It's all interconnected. Everything literally is spiritual. But also spiritual means like the metaphysics, the understanding of our existence within multiple dimensions. And that's something I'll get back to. That's kind of the big key actually. So Paradigm Shift London, we meet every Friday, we have these discussions, afterwards we go out for food, we build community. This is something that I'm encouraging other people to do, because all the people who I've connected with my community, there's over 100, there's like 200, more than that, people within London who I have personally met, who I know are interested in changing themselves and changing the world and thinking outside the box, and who just have that little extra to show up at the meetings in the first place. And that's again something I'll talk about, you know, like what's the system that we're living in? What's the situation of Babylon that we're living in? A lot of people, they are sort of being distracted by so many things, and that's really the case. It's not even like, oh, they're lazy, or oh, they're this. Like, last thing we want to be doing is blaming them, but rather observing what are the occurrences that lead up to the situation of someone being apathetic at home. And that is something that ultimately Paradigm Shift is helping change, is helping shift. You know, I think the big thing is that a lot of people in this world are apathetic. Paradigm Shift is inspiration. It is the idea of someone stumbling upon our website, and through the website we also do an online radio show, which is a big part of it. In the same way we have our physical communities, we also have a digital aspect where every week people from all over the globe tune into our radio station, which I host using my skills through what I went to college for, the media theory and production. And doing the radio show is a huge aspect of it, and it allows people to create a space where they can practice having these discussions, again, about things that are outside the box. And then out of that, again, what I want people to do is I want people to feel a sense of community, to have that sense of community, to be able to say, wow, I'm not alone. Because when we go back to that person who we were saying, why are they apathetic? Maybe they're apathetic because they think they're alone, because they think they have no one to talk to. Maybe they actually are an incredibly intelligent person who's absolutely passionate about changing the world, yet just doesn't know how and doesn't have the people to talk to about it. Paradigm shift is that solution, is the opportunity for someone to say like, hey, come get involved with this community, practice speaking your voice. Because the most important thing that we can do, I think, amongst many things, is listen, give people someone to listen to. A lot of people, they want to be able to say things, but they have no one to say them to. Paradigm shift is someone, is a place where they can come, that person, that someone, and they can share whatever it is that they want to share. So the project has evolved over the years, and again, it goes back to what began in around 2008, 2009. And through my own experiences, I became very aware of synchronicity. And even since a young age, I was always just thinking, like I want to be able to change the world. Like, I can do it. It's not impossible. Like, surely there's a way to do it. And especially with the internet, like I said, the internet was becoming, I could see where technology was going. I'm like, I need to prepare for this 5 years before we get to where we are. I'm well aware of what we can do with it, so I need to start getting ready for it. So, paradigm shift was the answer to my question, to a young boy's question of how can I change the world? And I can change the world by A, following my heart and building a community with the knowledge and understanding, the innate knowledge and understanding that I had of synchronicity. And that's something I'll talk about. I knew that it's a simple idea. If you build it, they will come. We heard about it in Field of Dreams, and we've heard about it a million times in different other ways. As you think, so shall you become. I knew that given that my interests were honest, that if I tried to make a community, I would meet the right people to make that community. And all I had to do was remain consistent and remain patient with it. And so basically, it started off as a single club in my college. Like I said, it was just me and a few friends. It was just, I happened to have some really close friends in my class, and there's literally just like three or four of us. And these were the type of buddies who, at lunch, we would talk about things like UFOs, like Sasquatch, like ghosts, like paranormal, lucid dreaming, like I mentioned. And then it began to expand further into that. You know, I was still learning and everything too, and that's where you started to get into the idea of like energy healing and Reiki, and just all sorts of other experiences that are innate within this reality that aren't just things that are, oh, just because you read it on the internet, it's probably fake. Like, no, the fact that it's ending up on the internet means that it's probably from something, even if it's something quite ancient. So we set out, and again, I knew that synchronicity was sort of the underlying force that was gonna bring everything together. And just a show of hands, who here sort of has their own understanding of what synchronicity means? Just about everyone, yeah. So synchronicity is another word for coincidence. What does coincidence mean? Coincidence means coinciding incidences. We often don't think about it that way, but when we say it that way, it becomes incredibly obvious. Coinciding incidences. That means that even when one thing's over here, if it does something, it's going to affect something over here. In this situation, the coinciding incidences have the potential to be people. Have the potential for two people to be in the same spot at the same place because for whatever reason they were drawn together. And that is like where you can get into this idea of us being much more than our physical body, of the idea that we exist beyond the present moment. We exist in the now, we perceive through the now, but we exist beyond the now. We exist into the future as much as we exist into the past. So in that sense, I knew, I put forth the intention. Intention is like a boomerang. You take a boomerang and you throw it. You put an intention on it and you throw it. And then eventually that boomerang is going to come back, but it might take a while. And if you have patience for it, you'll be there to catch it when it comes back. Oftentimes we'll put out an intention and then we'll be like, yeah, whatever, you know, it's not coming back. And then we just walk away and then it comes back and we're not there to catch it. So patience is a big thing when it comes to, these are simple ideas like manifestation, law of attraction. So these were the basic ideas that I knew that there were other people out there who shared my vibration. And that's kind of this idea, is that people who share similar interests have the potential to naturally gravitate towards each other. So I also understood a huge part about the potential of symbols, the potential of symbols being able to carry energy. And this is something that is all throughout culture, but we don't even really think about it too much. We see it through advertisement, but we don't really think about it too much. Everything is magic. Magic with a K. Magic with a C refers to, like, David Copperfield's stage illusion. Magic with a K, M-I-G-I-K or C-K, refers to how things are brought into this reality. And more so than that, the ability to be involved with the process of how things are brought into this reality. Being able to accelerate things, being able to put more intention in towards what will come out. And I understood through the magic of symbols, which can also be thought of as sigils, S-I-G-I-L-S, which is sort of the magic term for symbols. Sigils are something that we put energy into. So right now, what I'm wearing on my chest, this here right now, this is the paradigm shift sigil. This is what came before the club even began. This is something that I drew just because it just came out of me. It was something that came through me. You know, in terms of ideas, ideas aren't something that are just in here. Ideas exist everywhere. And if we attune our frequency to them, we can pick up on certain things. So my frequency, my antenna, my third eye, the third eye is literally an antenna for source, for higher consciousness, if you want to think about it that way. My third eye was attuned to the symbol that brought this in. And just recently I found out more as to how potent this symbol is, because it actually maps out very neatly over top of the original rune. And a lot of you may not know what the original rune is. If I could describe it for you, it's a hexagram on top of another hexagram. And I can show you more what that looks like, but basically it's kind of like this if you were to connect all the lines. Anyways, this is a very, very ancient symbol. This is something that's recently just come into my path. And this is something like the Nordic runes. Everyone knows the Nordic runes. Those were made out of the original rune. If you connect all the lines, the runes are all in there. It's the same source through which all of our symbols within religions have come out of. And there's a lot more to it, and it's all sacred geometry, and it's very interesting, and it maps out dimensions, and it has to do with the chakras, and there's a lot to it. This came out of it too. That's just something I wanted to share, because it's just something I found out recently. But this is something that even when I first made it, I'm like, all right, this is going to be my symbol. This is going to be my team logo. This is going to be something that I'm going to put on a poster at my school, put up there, and I know that somebody, maybe one in 200, would be the right person who would walk past and be like, do, what's that symbol? You know, and then they sort of stop and turn, and it would see them in a sense, you know, and then they pick up on it and they turn. And so this sigil was just an aspect of something I attached to the posters, like I said, to the online videos that I was doing. It was something that was going to carry this entire project, and it's carried it up until this point. Now maybe it has nothing to do with the sigil. Maybe this story could still be exactly as it is without the sigil. Maybe it could look like something else. I don't know, but the fact that it is, it's been a big part of the story, and it's going to continue to be a big part of the story. And we can all create our own sigils. We can all create our own custom symbols. That's something you can do. There's a whole thing about practical magic I could get into. But basically, I encourage you to do that. Doodle something, and then put an intention into it, and then doodle it again later in the day, or have it on a piece of paper to look at, and every time you look at that, it will bring something back. It will bring back the intention that you put, and when you trigger that intention within here, it sends out the signal to the universe, and then the universe will bring it back to you. So this here for me has kept me aligned with what my intention is for this project. And this intention is to bring more love into this world, you could say. Everyone deserves to be happy. Through these communities, people are becoming more self-empowered. They're gaining access to information and knowledge that is giving them the strength to change themselves, giving them the ways to change themselves, which in turn change the world, and they themselves. Like I said, the people through the radio show, the simple way how this works, I'll be on the radio show, I'll be kind of just telling you what I'm telling you now, and be like, hey, I created this awesome community, I met some of the most amazing people of my life, they're all my great friends, you can do it too. And that is like kind of the big thing, is that it's giving people that inspiration to be like, yeah, like some guy, some kid up in Canada did it. We can do it too, you know? And maybe they have a buddy and then they start a club in a college, and then next thing you know, you got other people coming together, and then it blossoms. It blossoms, and if it works one way, if it works in one place, it can work in any place. So the posters started going up around the college, and through there, more people just started coming out. We had presentations about lucid dreaming. We had presentations about life beyond death. We had my Reiki instructor come in, and he was a very interesting man because his background was very much in science. And here it was, a scientist who was talking about how he was skeptical about Reiki, about energy healing, yet through his own scientific practice was revealed that there's something to it. So it was like, oh, you know? And so it was interesting to hear him talking about how Reiki worked, just as an example of one of the teachers, one of the people that we had come in. So that kept on happening. And basically from there, like I said, it evolved out of the club. I graduated from college. The club still exists in the college. So there's Paradigm Shift Fanshawe and Paradigm Shift London. Paradigm Shift London, we meet downtown at the downtown yoga studio right across from Central Library. Every Friday at 6:45 p.m. I do have some pamphlets I can give you afterwards. And those are both happening right now. And like I said, so there's the whole aspect of this, and then there's the whole aspect of this, of documenting this, of being able to share the story. That's part of the big idea of the magic, is that the camera is something so sacred when you think about it. Like, it's literally capturing an essence of God that can be rewatched in the same way that right now, like, we're all like, this is amazing. We're live right now. We're talking. This is amazing. This can share an aspect of that with someone on the other side of the world. So it's just stating the obvious. But through this, the project has evolved. On my YouTube channel, I'm getting up to 500 videos. 100 of those are the radio show at least. I often will document my free hug adventures. That's one of the big things that I'll do, and I like to do them in the sense of like a tutorial. So it's showing what I'm doing, but it's also showing someone how they can do it too. And it's quite simple. Anybody can do a free hugs thing. And the beauty of what makes it work through these acts of shiftivism, again, it goes with the idea that when we do something like that, we become a gravitational force that attracts people to where we are. So I can stand downtown on one street corner with a free hug sign, and as long as I'm like in the zone and happy, as you know, if I'm just there, it's like, yeah, this probably isn't gonna work, and you know, I'm just like, whatever, you know, it might not work. It would just be less likely. So I need to meet the universe halfway, with the understanding that the universe is waiting for me to meet it halfway. Because a lot of people will say like, oh, just let it happen, just let it happen. Yes, but be aware as to how it's our responsibility to meet the universe halfway. You can think about that in an infinite amount of ways. So the free hugs thing is just another example of the fact that I can stand on a street corner and there will be, you know, like Sally Jane coming up the street, who's a university student, and she'll run into me. And then through that, what I actually do, it's funny, but it works so well. And I actually refer to it as hacking the matrix, because these tactics work so well that they connect people so instantly. Hacking the matrix is, and again, matrix is another word for Babylon. Matrix is a word for this reality. It's a word for the system. She will come up to me and she'll give me a hug, and then I'll say to her, because I'll have a sheet of my buttons, of my shift buttons, and I do have, like, you can just see here, like, this is just an example of one, but this is like the Eye of Ra. This is actually like one of my favorite ones, and one of the ones that I would give to a lot of people. And I'll have a sheet of them, and she'll give me a hug, and I'll say, congratulations, you passed the test. Now you get a free button. And so she's super happy about the hug, and then she gets a button, and on the buttons, there's a website. There's the website, paradigmshiftcentral.com, as well as the radio show on the bottom. And I'll also give her a pamphlet, and I'll be like, here, this is also an invitation. We do a regular open-minded discussion meditation circle every Friday at the downtown yoga studio. Everyone's welcome to come out. Maybe we'll see you there sometime. And lo and behold, she's like, you know what? This is exactly what I was looking for. This is exactly what I was looking for. I was just talking about this with someone else. And it will change her life. And you think about it, like is that going to change your life? It has the potential to. And the reason for that is because once she shows up to that meeting, like that window is open. That's what I've done to her. Like I haven't, you know, that it's kind of that saying that the most we can do is like open the door, but someone else has to walk through it. You can't push someone through a door. So I'm going around on a weekly, monthly basis through online things, and I'm opening doors for people. I'm just like, come on in, doors open. Like let's have a celebration. And what are we celebrating? Well, that's something I'll get next. So again, she has that opportunity to show up, and through there, she may find so much fulfillment in this community, and she'll be like, wow, you know, this is inspiring me. Maybe I wasn't like, now I'm gonna become a Reiki master because I know that there are people like this, and because I know, even though my roommate thinks I'm a little like out there, I know that there's people here who are also like, you know, we're all out there, whatever, right? So it's all in here. I mean, to be honest, but again, that's just an example of how that can change your life. And this is happening online through the internet. There's a bunch of stuff that I've done through my videos, and I've actually made full-length movies. I mentioned to you there's the previous movie that I did, If I Should Fall. That in itself, it's not part of Paradigm Shift, it's a big part of my life. But I also made movies after that, and they're of festivals that I went to in the United States, and they're conscious festivals, and these are gatherings where people are coming together at like a whole festival. So I mean, everyone here, like it would be something where you could meet someone and be like, oh, you know, like tell me what are your thoughts on this? What are your thoughts on this? And everyone's there to celebrate because we see it as like a family reunion, a soul gathering reunion. So anyways, just as what I'm saying is I've made two full-length movies of those. Those are available through the website. Every day, because of the magic of the internet, there are people who are stumbling upon my videos and they're seeing them and they're being like, whoa, this is something different. This isn't just a video of like, you know, like a dog like with a hat on or some weird cat video or hilarious cat video, I should say. You know, there's all these, they're funny. Oh, absolutely. And cats are teachers in themselves. Absolutely. So what I'm trying to say is that they'll come across them and be like, there's a level of like, it's something, there's genuine, you know, and they'll say that. And that's something that, yes, I put that into my work. I put it into my work. So it's my experience at festivals told, but it's also like educational. And the big thing with my media, be it the radio show, be it my movies, be it my free hug videos, I always try to make them entertaining, educational, and inspirational. I don't want someone to just be like, oh, that was awesome, but it has no impact on my life whatsoever and I'll forget about it in 5 minutes. I want someone to see the video and be like, oh, that's awesome. I'm gonna talk to my friend, and we're gonna do that next weekend, and we're gonna go get free hugs, and we're gonna meet people, and that's gonna change lives, and then boom, turns into a community, changes everything, creates a new reality. So that's kind of what I'm doing, is that I'm trying to constantly create new realities, birth new realities through actions. And sometimes we can feel this. We can feel when we don't do it more so than anything. And what I mean by this is sometimes I'll be on a bus, and I'll see someone, this hasn't happened in a while, and I'll see someone and I'll just be sitting there with my headphones on and I'll be like, I should probably give that guy a pamphlet and invite him out to the meeting. And then I'll just be like, but I'm kind of just probably going to sit here with my headphones on and not worry about it because it's not a big deal, so who cares, whatever. And then I won't do it. And then he'll walk off the bus and then I'll be like, why do I feel weird about that? Why do I feel like I should have given it to him? Or I know I could have, but I didn't. And then that, what I've learned from lessons like that, is that actually encourages you to remember how that felt in order so you'll do it next time. And be like, I know what that was when I didn't do it. Next time, I'll do it. I'll make it up for it. And if it was really meant to happen, I'll run into that guy giving free hugs on a street corner. So I'm not even too worried about it, right? London's a small town. And that's the beauty of it. Everybody knows that, like, London, Ontario, Canada, everybody knows that it is, like, the startup city for new projects, for new products, you know, they bring things here, and if they can work in London, they can work anywhere. So it's very synchronistic that I just happened to find myself in London, and we moved here when I was like 16 or whatever, like, and everything like that. But it turned out to be the perfect place for something like this to happen. So what is it that I feel is like the big paradigm shift? So I mean, like I said, we're building community, we're bringing people together, people are getting inspired. all these videos are going out on the internet. I'm encouraging other people to create their videos so I can share them with a global audience. People are getting on the radio show. They're excited and we're coming together, and there's something more. Because the people who are coming together, they're beginning to wake up to the idea that this physical body isn't all we are. And as simple as that sounds to some people here, because some people here are just like, well, of course. You know, of course, I've known that for quite some time. There's a lot of people who don't think that way. And when you think about the way as to how Babylon is controlling us, oftentimes they'll use fear. And talking about this is part of the equation, and I'm just helping you guys be more aware of one of the ways to see it. But a big thing that they do is they impose this fear where they convince people that, like, your physical body is all there is. Like, you better not screw this up. You should be afraid to die because that's all you got. But then other people have this idea where it's just like, well, hold on, you know, like, I don't think that's quite how it is. And more so than that, I don't think your fear should allow me to, like, live any less of the life that I see myself capable of living. So the big thing that I've woken up to, that other people have woken up to, that people are waking up to, is this remembrance. Is this remembrance that there's a whole experience we've all had before we showed up here in the physical. And it's weird to think that, because we're just like, oh, we'll find out when we die. Well, we will die. We will all find out when we die. And we can also find out before that. We can find out through meditation. We can find out through other experiences. We can find out by writing down our dreams. We can experience firsthand an aspect of perceiving reality that's outside of this physical body. We can be in a space and be like, this is a present moment. This is real. But I'm nowhere near my physical body right now. And we can have those experiences. And what do those experiences teach us? They teach us many things. One of the most valuable things that I've gotten out of all of this paradigm shifty stuff, and shifty stuff's the term I embrace quite proudly, you know, when I say it, because it actually kind of came from my parents first. I think they were the ones who started to be like, oh yeah, you guys are talking about that shifty stuff again. And I'm just like, yeah, I like that, you know? So I sort of turned it into a positive thing, right? It always was a positive thing. So through the shift, a big part of it is realizing that, like, we are spirit. We are all one. We are soul. We are part of a higher soul that has broken itself into a billion different fragments in order for it to have unique experiences, in order for it to learn in ways that it has never learned before. Maybe Earth isn't the only place where humans exist. Maybe there's something special about Earth that called us to here. Maybe we've already existed on other planets, yet something about Earth brought us here because we said, hey, this is going to be unpredictable. This is going to be something that's going to have some highs, and it's going to have some lows. You're going to have great Friday evenings, and then your basement's going to flood the next day. Whatever it is, right? We'll get through it. It's okay. So we have all chosen to be here. That's a big thing. And what we can get out of that is a reflection of why did we come here? And that's a big question, and it's not something that you necessarily need to have the answer to, because sometimes the answer is to live in the mystery. It's to live between the question and the answer. But we all came here with a contract, I guess you could say. And ultimately, the contract of each of us has brought us into this room, because within each of your contracts, you guys have done something to say, I'm going to help make this world a better place. I'm not going to sit by and be passive. I'm not going to just watch it go by. I want to be a part of it. I want to be a part of the show. I want to be up on stage. I want to play my part. I want to sing. I want to dance. I want to get an applause at the end that says, bravo, bravo. You did good. You did the best you could. So come here with the idea of asking yourself, how can we do the best we can? One of the best ways that we can do the best we can is to let go of fear. And like I said, when we let go of what the mainstream sort of imposing ways of society are putting on us, when we don't let their imposition of fear decide how we'll live, we can live free of fear. We understand that fear is an illusion. Fear is false expectations appearing real, as an acronym, I like to say. So when we can let go of fear, it empowers us because it brings us back to the idea that each one of us is a divine spark. And with that divine spark comes the idea that each one of us is a creator within this reality. Because through this paradigm shift, the big thing is we begin to understand that this reality isn't as cut and dry as it appears to be. It's not as physical as it appears to be. Yes, this is physical by our definition. Some of you have probably heard that it's actually 99.9% empty space. What does that mean? It means that things are in a certain vibration that are keeping them appear solid. You change that vibration a little bit, things aren't as solid. This is something we can experience within dreams. The spirit, the consciousness, exists through multiple levels. And it may be like, maybe this, and don't even just end it, like it's kind of getting outside things here, but like even just to say we're a spirit, like what are we before we're a spirit? Whoa, you know, like who, like that's kind of like a big kicker when I'm just kind of asking like big questions. It's just like people talk about like God and stuff like that. And if we're just talking about like the big guy in the sky in sort of the old fashioned sense, it just brings me back to like this comical moment that I had that was part of a movie that I was doing. But long story short, I was talking to God on the phone and I said to God, I was like, all right, God, thanks. Bye. Tell your mom and dad I said hi. What? Who's the mom and dad of God? What does that mean? You know, so I'm just saying, like, play around with ideas. Don't necessarily think that you have to have everything figured out. But within the idea of figuring out, there's certain aspects that I can assure to you are, you can repeat them. You can experience them. And one of the things is this direct experience of our thoughts creating reality. And this is like the ancient wisdom of the sages that is coming back up to the surface. The big thing with this paradigm shift is that we're remembering, like I said, in ancient teachings, like things going back to like the Kabbalah, like the Kabbalah, which teaches about the dimensions of reality and astral projection and lucid dreaming. It in itself is just like all of that information is coming up to the surface through the internet, and it's really just been happening. The last 5 years have been a very exciting time. And I've been able to witness it firsthand through the internet, through my browsing and stuff like that. I've been able to see Facebook as just one window of this, where the conversations were meh, and now they're quite here. They've exploded in a fractal sense. And people are gaining access to this idea. They're gaining access to ideas that maybe we're actually more psychic than we realize. So the interconnectedness between all of us is a big part of understanding more about what this reality has to offer, and more so than that, what our potential is within it. And that's ultimately what I want to teach people about, is what potential do we have within this reality and other realities. So for example, like I said, thoughts can create reality, the psychic nature of our interconnectedness, the idea that everything is vibration, everything gives off energies, and we are constantly receiving these energies whether or not we are aware of it. We think that right now our eyes are depicting to us what is a true form. They're true, but true within the confines of the illusion itself. Outside of the illusion, this is not what reality looks like. This is just what reality looks like in order for us to show up here, in order for us to be able to navigate through it, in order for us to not be distracted by the fact that if we, for example, you know, we all know that animals and insects can see things quite differently. It's not because they're a bug and we're a human, it's just because their eyes are tuned to a different frequency. Maybe our eyes can tune to different frequencies too, and I can assure you that they can. And a lot of that has to do with opening up the third eye, and that's where we get people talking about being able to see auras. They can see the subtle energies that are right there all around us. When you go through this shift, you're waking up to these spiritual ideas, the idea we're more physical body. Being able to see beyond the veil is kind of one of the ideas. So seeing beyond the veil, first of all, it means seeing beyond the illusion of separation. Everybody here is sitting here in this room, all of us have our own individual names, yet the beautiful thing about it is that we're actually one person, you know, and that's the beauty of it. One being, you know, and that is such an amazing thing when you can really see it, when you can look into someone. And that's where, again, it brings back the wisdom of namaste. Namaste means the light within me sees the light within you. And that is what we are. We are propagating light that uses this body to experience itself through these little little holes that we refer to as eyeballs that allow consciousness to see itself through. But actually, this is kind of, think about this what you want, but in the midst of understanding everything, you actually realize that everything in this reality is actually like made up of like bubbles attached to bubbles attached to bubbles, or squares attached to squares attached to squares, sacred geometry attached to sacred geometry. It's all connected. It can sort of look like a honeycomb. It can look like whatever patterns you want. But it's also, all of it, they're all eyeballs. Every single atom is an eyeball. And what I mean by that is that it's a lens for consciousness to be able to perceive itself through. The Dalai Lama even says that every atom is a black hole. This goes in hand with the idea of holographic reality, and this is how synchronicity works. This is how I can be over here and my friend Joe is way over there, and somehow we're connected despite the fact that we haven't met in person. And that connection is what draws us together, because that connection exists in the future. And I know I'm jumping around a lot here, so I hope this will all just sort of allow itself to naturally sort of spark things within inside of you, natural things where we can just sort of be like, oh, I've had a similar thought, or oh, that makes sense. And then encourage you to sort of play around with these ideas further. So dreams are a huge part about reality. And through dreams, we can experience the fact that like we have the ability to create reality. Through lucid dreams. Lucid dreams are when you're awake within your dream, when you know that you're dreaming. That's when you have a moment to be like, hey, I want to fly. And you can fly. But then at the same time, you can be like, hey, I want to fly. It's not working. Oh, my feet are stuck in the ground. What's going on here? And it's really difficult. But the trick that's holding us back is that it's all in the mind. And that's actually part of the experience of learning how to fly. It's learning how to let go. It's learning how to let go of the idea that within this reality, we're so used to moving things with our hands. Within the dream, we're using our astral body. So it's commanding. It's sort of like you're directing from a single point, which is your third eye, so to speak, and you're just sort of like letting go and moving. You don't even have a physical body when you're dreaming. We just imagine that we do because it's something that we're quite familiar with. So before we were born, we were in these astral realms. And there's actually, some people will say that, like I use the astral realms as just the realms that are sort of like outside of this realm that are kind of like the dream realms. And these are also the realms that we're in when we're born, and they're also the realms that we'll go to when we die. And in that sense, a big part of the paradigm shift is actually, as many of you know, when people die, they're not actually gone. They don't disappear with the bones that we put in the ground. They, as consciousness, exist through the infinite amount of little eyeballs that are around us, is what I was saying. They don't need a physical body in order to sort of float through and be able to see. So I mean, they don't have to have a body, but they can be right up there and they can be floating around. They can be looking at me because they're just kind of like, almost like, it's like water. We live in an ocean of energy. So it's not like a matter of like, well, what are they floating in and stuff like that. Again, just because we can't see the energy doesn't mean that it's not there. So we're in an ocean of energy, and our thoughts are constantly putting things out, and they're constantly creating the world around us. And when we're in our dream, it's instantaneous. And when we're here, it just takes a little bit longer, but it still happens. It's still this idea of what you put out, you will attract. And here we play around with this idea of time. Time is what makes this unique. There's this consistency to it, but time, what does it do? Ultimately, it allows things to grow with consistency, which is a very interesting experience, because when we chose to come here as a soul, we almost, you know, had to double check and be like, all right, like, are you sure you want to go in? Because once you go in, you're not getting out for a while. Like, it's going to feel like a lifetime, but you'll wake up out of it at the end and be like, oh, that was interesting. That was fun. That was exciting. And it'll have like, you know, it won't, you're out on that higher dimensional level. And that's where you get into the idea of like dreams within a dream. Is this a dream? Yes. But that doesn't make it any less worth of a dream. It makes it even more fulfilling when we understand that this is a dream within a dream, because we realize that we can create within the dream. If we understand that we can create within our sleeping dreams, we can understand that we can create within our dreams here. If I want to create a community online and change the world and connect with people and work through the physicalness of this reality and go through the struggles along the way, I can do it. And you can do stuff too. You guys can create art. You can write stories. You can pull things from your dream and bring them into this reality. You can learn lessons within your dream. So we're constantly learning. And a big thing, again, like, you know, like the shift, it's a big part of it is being able to see the lessons in every moment. A lot of people, again, if they're being oppressed by fear, they'll respond to things with frustration. They'll be like, oh, why did this happen to me? Bah, da, 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 da. I'm a victim. Ah, this isn't working. And those are the people that we're ultimately trying to help. Last thing we want to do is be like, well, it's your fault, man. You're just attracting it. You know, when we have systems like that that are imposing fear, it's hard to sort of change the mentality of people. It's going to take generations. But people can wake up within an instant, and they can wake up to the idea of understanding that there's other people out there who are also thinking outside the box. So when we understand that everything is a lesson, that's a huge paradigm shift. So there's all these little paradigm shifts that are happening along the way. And again, you know, paradigm shift, to change your paradigm, to change the way you see things. At once I thought I was just Brendan, and I was just like a physicalness, and I was so physical, and I was just in this physical world, and I was born and then I'm gonna die. Now it's just like, I see myself from a little bit bigger of a picture. Yes, I'm still Brendan. That's the me who I chose to be. That's the character that I'm playing. That's the actor. That's the role that I'm fulfilling right now. But ultimately, I'm you, which is interesting. And again, I know I just said that like 10 minutes ago. But like still, it's just like oh my God, like that just, it's amazing, because I'm the part of you that came here to help you remember who you are. And in the same way that I'm still learning, and we're all still learning, and we're all teachers, and we're all students, and that's the big thing, is that I'm always learning. People will say I'm an old soul. That is an interesting idea, I can understand it, but that doesn't make me any more like capable of changing the world than you are, sort of thing. Like, everybody has that spark within them to have an amazing experience, to inspire others. And maybe what you're here to do is to inspire, like, to help, like, one person. Maybe that's what you're here to do. Maybe you're here just to help yourself. Whatever it is that's true to your heart is what you're here to do. And when we let go of the fear, when we remove the dust from the hearts of our lens, then we can begin to live a more authentic life. And ultimately, that's what I'm trying to do with Paradigm Shift. I'm trying to encourage people to live more authentically, to live authentically to themselves, and to live with a sense of empowerment. And again, there's all these little paradigm shifts along the way. We are more psychic than we realize, and all we have to do is sort of pull back the barriers, the filters that are in our way. And again, like, this goes hand in hand with all sorts of other stuff that connects to the process of healing the planet. As we heal the planet, we heal ourselves. As we heal ourselves, we heal the planet. We are an extension of the planet, and that is a big part of what we're trying to do right now. So we're trying to change the world by changing ourselves. And with that said, I think I only got like 30 seconds as it is on the official clock. And in that sense, I'm just gonna continue to keep doing what I'm doing. There's so many other mysteries out there. There's so many other experiences that I've yet to walk into yet. And the most that I can do is understand that every great challenge is just training for the next one. Every lesson that we learn is preparing us for the future lessons to come. So if we are aware that they're lessons in the first place, we can step into our role as a better student. And when we have community, we can reflect with each other. We can be like, hey, this is something I'm learning. This is something I'm putting together. This is something I'm piecing together. And then we start adding, we start collaborating, and we create a collective vision of where we are. And that expands. That expands beyond the community. And ultimately, it's about the future. I think we can all agree with that, is that we would give it all up to be able to ensure that the future generations can have a little bit more light, can have that ability to live an honest life. And that is a noble cause. That is a noble cause that I'm thankful that all of us, and when I say all of us, I literally mean all of us, people watching this, all of us can be a part of. The only thing that we have to do is make the choice. And I'll leave it with that, is the idea of what my shirt says, and that says, choose to be the change you wish to see. Gandhi said, be the change you wish to see, choose to be the change you wish to see, which means it comes from the free will. And free will is a conversation for another day, but ultimately that's the gift. We have the free will. We have the free will to choose to be the change we wish to see. So I'll end it there.
Take us from the meditation. Yeah, we're going to meditate.
And yes, I can lead us through a meditation, and we'll do that to close it off.
Keep it for about 5 minutes. Okay, you want to turn the lights on?
I got my singing bowl, so. And it's always fun to talk about that, to share that story, even just for myself. Because every time I'll tell it differently, right? And I mean, the last time I was here, well, it's interesting, because today, at the time it's recording, today's World Peace Day. I don't know if a lot of you knew that, so happy World Peace Day, everyone. And then the last time I was here was on November 11th, so we're doing a pretty good job of picking out these dates, so, yeah. But yes, thank you again, and of course, if you have any questions, we can always talk after. But with that said, we'll move into our meditation. So if everybody just wants to relax, as per Hank's instructions, I'll keep this fairly short, yet still give us the opportunity to just be. So just relax your body, just relax your shoulders, just allow yourself to find a comfortable position and be able to move into a place of stillness. In this stillness, be able to connect with the present moment. So let's just connect with our breath. It's a gentle inhale through the nose. Gentle exhale through the nose. Again, gentle inhale. Gentle exhale. And continue to breathe, continue to find the rhythm of your breath. Each exhale, just allowing yourself to become more relaxed. You're going to begin playing the singing bowl. And for this moment, you can simply keep your attention on your breath, the ebb and flow of it, like waves coming in and rolling back out. Or just simply allow your mind to see whatever it is, whatever it brings you in this moment. Be it thoughts of joy, thoughts of gratitude, thoughts of love, thoughts of hope. Again, so just take another inhale and really bring it into your heart. Exhale. So continue to breathe. Continue to know that we're all an extension, that divine spark choosing to be here, to take part in this beautiful human experience, so that we can all learn, so that we can all celebrate, so we can all love together. Continue to breathe, continue to relax, continue to practice your meditation. Just being able to feel, being able to experience this place of calmness, stillness. It's a very valuable practice. Something we can give to ourselves to help us tune our instrument so that we can continue to play play our song amongst the universe. One verse, one song. Just connect with your breath. Just take a couple more gentle inhales. Gentle exhale. Again, once more. So leave here today, I hope you leave here today feeling slightly more inspired in the inspiration that I am happy to be able to share with you and the message of hope that I bring to you, knowing that amazing things are happening, that people all across the world are waking up right now. And you're a part of it too. So when you're ready, you can gently bring your awareness back to your physical body. You begin to wiggle your toes and your fingers. When you're ready, you can gently open your eyes to the room around you. So just to bring a conclusion to this, just want to say thank you again to everyone, and as I like to say, we'll finish with a namaste. So namaste, among many other things, means the awesome within me sees the awesome within you. So to everyone here, thank you, and namaste. And thank you, Hank. And thank you, everyone. So,
and Margaret.
And Margaret, and everyone, so.
Thank you.
Awesome.
For being here.